Hello everyone, and welcome back to my Realism Overhaul series in Kerbal Space Program 0.24.2. In the previous episode, I tried to bring this little lander pack over to Mars, Phobos, and Deimos, one lander for each of those bodies. However, I got betrayed by Mars' atmosphere, which refused to actually slow all this down. And I'm going to show in this episode, in the beginning of this episode, that I'm not in fact insane, and yes, it was the fact that it wasn't applying drag correctly to this craft, and in order to prove that, I'm going to do very expensive drop tests. We are sparing no expense, we are actually using the exact stage. I mean, of course, NASA would use some sort of dummy thing, but I want to show that it is, in fact, a problem with the way drag was calculated on this. So everything is the same up to the decoupler, including the decoupler, it's the same decoupler. And then I've attached a tank with a Merlin 1C engine, which happened to be the most appropriate engine for this purpose. And so we're going to launch it up to 30 kilometers and see what the drag is, basically, and see how it slows down. Okay, and then we're going to test it with putting a heat shield on the bottom of it, or perhaps a different part. We'll do three tests, a random different part, and then a heat shield. And then we'll see what the difference is. Okay, I'm not going to put a fairing on this. I don't think I'll need one. Actually, that'll be an interesting thing to test as well, to see how fast we can go without a fairing. But, yep. Let's see how this works. Expensive, but necessary. Now, obviously, this is not going to be traveling under the conditions that was on Mars. It's not going as fast. It's not going horizontally. We've got to be tossing it up and down. And we're going to be tossing it up to 30 kilometers is my plan. We can't go too far downrange because I don't want to extend the antennae. They'll snap off in the atmosphere anyway. So we'll lose control. Not that we really need control, but anyway, let's get started here. But that doesn't matter that we're not in the exact same conditions, because what we're really interested in is this number, the coefficient of drag. And if that's different between one test and another, that will show what I want to show. That it is, in fact, the way the drag is being calculated on, in particular, this part, which is the part that was encountering the atmosphere. And what that will mean is that I simply can't have one of these procedural fuel tanks be the bottom part, or maybe it's somehow the way I've attached things. Remember, the way I've got all this stuff staged is a little bit weird. It's sort of all lumped here, and that's because of the way it'll eventually separate this. Yeah, I mean, if you haven't played around with these, it's a little bit complicated. Okay, I'm going to tilt to 85 degrees and leave it there. I'm not going to do any more of a turn. Just a little bit there. Of course, this could all break apart because of atmospheric effects. The density of the atmosphere could hit this probe hard, but we're going to find that out too. No fairing. Give us some sense of the limits there too. I say we're going to go to 30 kilometers. That's how long I'm going to keep the engine on, I think, unless we start losing parts. Okay, shutdown. Our decoupling seems to be wrongly staged. Decoupling. Okay, so now we're on the... This is the surface that encountered Duna's atmosphere. We're going to lose control. We have no reaction wheel control. No point trying to control of RCS either. It'll just spin around, and then eventually once we head back down, the bottom will certainly face the retrograde vector. And that's because the bottom lander is the heaviest, by far. You'll notice how much the coefficient of drag increases as we spin around. Seems to hit a minimum of 0.1, and then a maximum of, let's say, 0.01, and then a maximum of 0.3. So here it's at its minimum. And then, of course, when the whole thing is facing it, maybe the reference area is this whole side here. I don't know why, but... So what I'm really looking for now is what our velocity is at 5 kilometers altitude. And that'll give us a reference point. That's all I really want here. Another reference point is, of course, the actual coefficient of drag, which as the thing faces the retrograde vector, it seems to be 0.011, which is very low as far as I'm concerned. Well, dynamic pressure is getting pretty serious now. We're not slowing down at all. We have hit terminal velocity and now we're slowing down. Okay. Still 0.01 on the coefficient of drag. More than 150,000 pascals in pressure. Velocity way above terminal velocity. And 760-ish meters per second at 5 kilometers. I think you'll agree that this is much faster than this would normally be going. And let's watch it. Loud sound coming up. Or not, it just got pulverized. Okay. Back to the VAB. Back to the VAB. Okay, so now I'm going to put in a heat shield and we're going to try again. So 3 meter heat shield, attachment point. And actually, let me quickly check what's the mass of it without the heat shield. Oh, it doesn't show the proper mass. Okay, let's see. What's the mass of the whole assembly without the heat shield? 33.5 tons. Okay, and now, but once again, doesn't show. Okay, that's that. Let's go this way. Okay, so 0.8 tons it looks like, and can we reduce that by reducing the amount of? Yeah. Okay. I'll just take 200 units of. I don't want to change the mass too much. Let's say around there, okay? So it'll be about 0.3 tons. That's not too bad in terms of changing the dynamics in terms of mass. And so let's go... Well, okay, let's just change that. Let's just dump all of the ablator shielding. So now it's just 0.1 tons. Okay, save and launch. Okie dokie, here we go. This is where we find out whether I'm insane or not. Alright, what is the drag coefficient on this? Now that I've made the modification where it's a different part. Now, of course, that part could have the same problem, but I'm not gonna claim that. The automatic response, if it turns out the drag is the same, is probably going to be, I guess that's the drag on this sort of thing. But I doubt that's going to happen. This drag doesn't matter right now. It's the drag coming down that we're interested in. So again, I'm going to, at about a kilometer altitude, tilt to 85 degrees and then let it go until 30 kilometers, as long as it doesn't fall apart. And then we're just going to bring it down from there. Okay, shut down. Make sure that's the right stage. Yes, separation. And now we'll wait till we are going down. Though the part where it spins is somewhat interesting still. Okay, it looks like, okay, on the previous test we had 0.01. And now we have 0.07677, but now it's tilting away from the retrograde vector. Let's get towards the retrograde vector to see what it is. Yeah, it's 0.09. Beats me why when it's tilting it actually has less of a drag on it, but well, now it's got more. Now our coefficient of drag is 0.1, which is 10 times what it was before. I think this is already pretty conclusive, but we'll wait for the 5 kilometer mark to see what our velocity is. Okay, coefficient of drag is now only 0.073, but that's enough, and as you can see at 5 kilometers we are at 170 meters per second, way, way lower by a factor of 5 than what we were with the previous configuration without the heat shield. So, and it's not the mass, because the heat shield is only really 0.1 tons, so, or something of that order. So yeah, it's somehow the way that the drag was calculated on our previous craft was incorrect. Basically, the way drag was calculated on this procedural real fuels tank, perhaps because it's so short, maybe it just doesn't like the fact that it's so tiny a tank. I don't know. Anyway, I don't think we need to go with further tests. I think we should just add a heat shield to it and try again. Okay, so let's try for Mars one more time, adding a heat shield to that craft. Of course, this means that I'm going to have to time warp through a whole bunch of the year. Unavoidable. Good thing we don't have any Kerbals in orbit or anything like that. Deliberately didn't start adding manned stuff to our space station, though we don't really have any manned pods to work with. For some reason, this tech tree doesn't give you much of that at all. It seems like they don't want you to do manned missions of anything with this tech tree. And I'm very sorely tempted to start a new Realism Overhaul series where crewed missions actually are more of a thing, which means perhaps not using the realistic progression like tech tree. Not that I think that we should start with crewed missions right away the way that the default tech tree works, but it should be a little bit quicker than we've got in this RPL tech tree, where I still only have a single one-man pod, and 16 years into the thing, maybe I should have a little bit more than that. Okay, that's about 45 degrees, right? Think so. Okay, let's go to VAB. Well, after the drop tests, I'm almost tempted not to have the fairings on, but let's not go that far. The fairings are very massive, though. They're about 7 tons. But all we really need is a fairing, not a fairing, a heat shield right there. Let's use the exact same heat shield for consistency. And I'm going to allow it to have a little bit of actual heat shielding. Let's say a third of its normal amount. Let me vary it and see how much that affects our delta V. It's not much. Could pack it full, but I don't think we need that much. A little bit will do, though. I think it'll be a good idea to have some heat shielding on us. Okay. So, hopefully second time's the charm. We've got this all packed and ready to go. Yep, alright. Let's hope for the best. Okay, we're all lined up. Unfortunately, that does mean that we are once again launching in the dead of night. Let's get throttle up, SAS on. But we're gonna be starting our maneuvers pretty darn quickly. This thing does not take very long to get to orbit. Alright, 0.72 sounds fine to me, so here we go. Engine's lit. And off it goes. Gonna try and see how flat this thing can get. Still have an optimized trajectory of this particular rocket. Well, it sure looks like we can flatten out quicker than this. Critical region is between 30 and 40 kilometers though. Everything looks great. Roll yaw pitch, no wiggling. Firm Aerospace has it all nominal. Well, we're at 20 degrees, still 13 seconds away from booster separation. It's quite remarkable. Doesn't seem like the atmosphere even touches this thing. I hope that's not another drag problem, but no, it looks pretty reasonable right now. It's just the shape of it. Okay, here we go, booster set. Okay, just trying to restrain my orbit again as things get a little wild. Again, I can throttle this engine somewhat, but not fully. It goes down, right now it's probably around 70%. But it's off or on, I can't restart it once it's off. Well, we're quite out of whack here. But it'll have to do. Okay. Fairing set. Again, still having some trouble with that. I guess it's just a bug in 64-bit that I'm not going to be able to deal with. And separation of the first stage. Alright. Okay, we are in orbit. Our two RL-10s are prepared, but we need to plot for Mars. Oh, I should get the antenna out as well. Okay, AIES antenna is out. We got to train the main dish to Kerbin/Earth. And if we have solar panels, we can get those out as well. Alright, now I'm going to plot for Mars. Okay, so I've made my own plot, and what I've got is a duna periapsis of 1,566 kilometers with an initial burn at Kerbin/Earth of 3,489, and then a mid-course plane change is 742, which we can easily do, provided that, well, I mean, the problem is the boil-off of the hydrogen, right? Because by the time we get here, we really won't be able to use this stage. Now, we've got the additional stage with the 8 1 kilonewton rockets that can manage to make course plane change easily. The question is whether I want to do that or whether I want to let MechJeb try and plot a much larger initial burn that will get us there quicker. And yeah, I think I'll let it do that. So we're going to opt for a quick rendezvous that has a high initial burn without a big mid-course plane change, and use that instead. That might complicate aerobraking, but that's what we were doing the last time anyway. So this I'm gonna swallow my pride. I'll use MechJeb. We designed computers in order to optimize trajectories in the first place. That's practically what they're for. So I'm going to go ahead And is it rendezvous planner? No, I think it is maneuver planner. Yeah, with the pork chop plot. So advanced transfer to another planet. Yeah, well, I've got the planet selected. Okay, so here's our pork chop plot. It needs somewhere in that region. Departure in 1 hour sounds fine. So the same thing that we had before. Create node. Okay, looks like a crash course with... Yes, it is the fast transfer at the sending node. It would have been tough for me to plot this manually. I knew where it was, it's just that I would have to be tweaking maneuver nodes constantly in order to get it. It ends up meaning that we approach Mars a lot faster. You can see the orbit that we end up in is a little bit a faster orbit than normal, but not too much faster, so I don't think it'll be a big pain to aerobrake that. Okay, so we're gonna go with MechJeb's suggestion because it'll make better use of the Centaur stage that we're using right now. Alright, well, I'll see you at the maneuver node. Now, I haven't made any changes to this aside from adding the heat shield, so no lights on the landers as before, and also I forgot to action group the little 1 kilonewton thrusters, so we're going to have to go with the same trick of shutting off their fuel when I don't want them to continue anymore. A little bit of a hassle, but not a huge thing. And let's see, fuel flow is very unstable, so I'm actually going to shut this down and let the 1 kilonewton thrusters do their thing before lighting this. So actually I don't know if that'll work out right. Well, let's keep it like this. I think it'll be fine. Yep. Okay. We're ready to go, but we could use a couple more minutes before we get started on this burn. Okay. So fuel flow is very unstable. I'm gonna settle it using the 1 kilonewton thrusters. Okay, now I'm going to activate. Very good. And then those go off. There's no throttling on this engine anyway, so. Okay, we are once again off to Mars. Probably I'm going to be ending this episode soon, and we're going to find out what happens at Mars in the next episode. That should at least prevent us from crashing too much on the way. I mean the game crashing, not the craft. So yeah, I'll let it cool down for a bit, and then I'll be in suspense as well, so it's not unfair, but we will find out in the next episode whether I was right. The heat shield is sufficient to bring us into orbit around Mars. And of course, we are on this fast transit, which means I should aim perhaps a little bit lower than I did with the previous mission, the one that was supposed to land on Phobos only. That mission aerobraked at Mars at 39 kilometers. But the problem with aiming a little bit lower is, of course, I'm going to have more heat. Now I've got a little bit of a blade of heat shielding, but I'm not sure that's going to be really sufficient to do all the work. So it's going to be a little bit tricky. Okay, I'll come back to you with the disposition of this after the Transmars injection or Mars burn if you'd like. Alright, getting ready to shut it off here. And that's it. It's better not to overdo it here. An adjustment burn will definitely be necessary. Let's see if we should apply it here or further out. Oh, looks like we actually did already overdo it, even though we still had 10 meters per second left to burn, at least. Seems to react better doing less here, though that might be deceptive. Okay, I've got it at a periapsis of 112 with this maneuver. I'll still use the Centaur stage for this. We should be able to relight it without any problems. Okay, still in the dark, but I completed that maneuver. Let's see how close we are. Still a little bit far off. I'm actually gonna ditch this stage now. And that will free up and unlock these guys. Let me think about it for a sec. That's on the wrong stage too. Good thing I checked. Alright, I think I'm gonna dump the Centaur stage now. Heat shield is now outward facing. And let me use the 1 kilonewton thrusters to get us a little bit closer. Okay, things are not going well in the whole optimization department here. I think I'm gonna have to take 9,500 kilometers until we get a little bit closer. We are still in Earth's sphere of influence here. Let's take it out to interplanetary space, and then at that point I will leave you, and we will find out what happens in the next episode. Were the little drop tests correct, and will I be able to have this get into a good orbit around Mars? I don't know. We are going to find out together. So, yep. Alright, with that, tune in next time. You know what we're going to do. We're going to try and land these probes on Mars, Phobos, and Deimos. And hopefully that's exciting enough to entice you back. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please do press like. If you have any comments or suggestions, please leave them in the comment section below. And I'll see you next time.